In the name of the Father,
and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgive.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful man.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The introit is the insert. Let us read responsively. Remember your congregation, which you have purchased of old.
Which you have redeemed to be the tribe of your heritage.
Remember this, O Lord, how the enemy scoffs.
And the foolish people reviles your name.
Do not deliver the soul of your dove to the wild beasts.
Do not forget the life of your poor forever.
Let not the downtrodden turn back in shame.
Let the poor and needy praise your name.
Have regard for the covenant.
Arise, O God, defend your cause.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Glory be to God on high.
And on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee. We glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heaven make
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord Almighty, everlasting God, you have commanded us to pray and have promised to hear us. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may direct and govern our hearts in all things, that we may preserve with steadfast faith, persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading is from Genesis, the 32nd chapter. The same night Jacob arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and everything else that he had, and Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise for the gradual. He will command his angels concerning you
to guard you in all your ways.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And all that is good in me, bless his holy name.
The epistle reading is from 2 Timothy, the 3rd and 4th chapters. As for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, and the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, and fulfill your ministry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought to always pray and not lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, give me justice against my adversary. For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, and so she will not beat me down by her continual coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says. And will not God give judges justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? This is the gospel of the Lord. Having heard the word of God, let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both living and dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church,
I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is the gospel reading appointed for this day. There we heard these words. Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. This is our text. Dear redeemed in Christ, in this passage, Jesus teaches us to pray boldly, to pray persistently, to pray never despairing of the Lord's desire to hear or to answer. In the New Testament reading, Jesus teaches us this in a parable. Parable of a widow persistent in her petition. Her petition to a hard, hard judge. The Old Testament reading teaches us the same thing. There, Christ likens persistence in prayer to a wrestling match. A wrestling match that went on all night. A man appeared to the patriarch Jacob and wrestled with him until daybreak. And the message in both cases is the same. Always pray and do not lose heart. Always pray and do not lose heart. Jesus teaches us to pray like this because genuine prayer does not come to us naturally. Oh, of course, all people know about prayer. Prayer is simply making a request or a petition. However, praying in such a way that pleases God is different. It is altogether different. It is different in this way. Prayer, apart from Jesus' word, is simply words of man-made perceptions. The Apostle John gives us an example of this. He writes, "You ask and you receive not, because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lusts." That is a perfect description of how the natural man prays. And that kind of prayer always misses the mark. We also recall how the disciples sensed the need to be taught how to pray. They wanted to learn to pray correctly according to the way of Jesus. In Luke 11, we read this, "And it came to pass that as he," that is Jesus, "was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples.' And then, hearing that, Jesus taught them the Our Father." He taught them the words of the Lord's Prayer. But we may say, well, we already know this. We've been taught this. We've been praying them daily. Why do we need to be taught this year after year in the appointed readings of the church? The answer is this. The answer is that life in Christ is a new life. Everything in it is new. It doesn't come from the ways of the old. It is the life of the new birth. Through Christ, we have been born again to live in the kingdom of our Father. And this new life is a living and a growing life. To live and to grow requires nourishment and exercise. It is a life of daily and continually learning and growing in the knowledge and wisdom of the really good things of God. Daily, we must nourish that life with the word of Christ, and in so doing, grow in our knowledge and understanding of Scripture, in wisdom, and of course, grow in prayer, in our prayer life. As we exercise ourselves in prayer and gain experience in prayer, passages like today's gospel reading continue to unfold new insights, and we grow stronger in boldness and persistence and confidence. Let us first review the Old Testament reading. There we heard that a man appeared to Jacob and wrestled with him until daybreak. That man was Christ. Jesus had appeared there, or we should say perhaps more correctly, the Son of God had appeared there in the form of a man to Jacob, and so Jacob was wrestling with Christ. And we say, how can it be Christ when Jacob lived hundreds and hundreds of years before Christ was born? And the answer is, this has happened several times in the Old Testament. A man appears who turns out to be God in the form of a man, and the man is the eternal Son of God in the form of a man. Luther talks about this. He talks about the wrestler in Jacob's case. Who is this wrestler? Luther writes this: "The wrestler is the Lord of glory, God himself, or God's Son, who was to come later in the flesh, and who appeared and spoke to the fathers." That's Luther. We know this man is God because also in the text, when he appeared to Jacob, he said to Jacob, "You have striven with God and prevailed." Jacob was wrestling with God. He was wrestling with Christ, the eternal Son of God, in the form of a man. This is one of those amazing visitations of the Lord. Amazing because the Lord wrestles with Jacob, and Jacob prevails. Did we notice that? God is there with Jacob, wrestling all night long, and Jacob wins the match with God. A man prevails with God. Let us underscore that by hearing those words again from the text. The Lord says, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, because you have striven with God and have prevailed. That's a marvelous thing. But God is doing it on purpose so that we might learn his heart and his will for us. So how was it that Jacob prevailed? Jacob asked God for a blessing. He wanted a blessing from God, and he would not let go until he received the blessing. Do we see the point? Jacob persisted with God until God answered with the blessing. And then if we turn to the New Testament reading for today, we learn the same point, only this time through a parable taught by Jesus. And the point of the parable is stated at the very beginning of the parable. There we heard the words, Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and never lose heart. Always pray and never lose heart. And then he presented this parable of this woman who wanted justice from that judge, and she just kept coming. She kept coming until she wore him out. And he said, okay, I'll give it to her. And he did. And so the woman there represents the faithful people of God's family. And the lesson is, again, always pray and do not lose heart, just like that woman and just like Jacob. Well, where does that persistence come from? Where does that confidence come from that wrestles with God and keeps going back and keeps going back? Where does that come from? Jesus here does not merely teach us to be bold and to come to our Father in prayer. He provides the confidence to do it. He provides the ability to do it. And that confidence comes through faith in Jesus' words and his promises concerning our well-being and concerning our prayers. How does this work? Jesus makes it happen by revealing to us the very heart of God. He shows us God's heart and his attitude and his desire towards us. And knowing the Father's heart gives us abundance, a superabundance of confidence to bring everything to him in prayer. And again, how does he do it? How does he reveal the heart of God? By way of the cross. That's how we know the heart of God. Look at Christ crucified. That shows you the Father's attitude towards us, his will towards us, shows us his heart. And it cost him dearly. For sinners cannot approach God, and we most certainly are sinners. Sinners cannot approach God by the measure of the divine law. In order to approach God, we must be righteous. Righteous in heart, mind, and deed. And that we all confess. We just confessed it a few minutes ago. That we are not. We are not that way by nature. But he made it right for us. That's the way of the cross. Through the cross, he brought into this world the gift of righteousness, the righteousness that can and does stand boldly in the presence of God. And this gift is for everyone. Any member of this world who repents of their sins and receives the gift of this righteousness by faith is considered pure and righteous in the presence of God's holiness. And it is a pure gift. We didn't earn one bit of it. Christ did on the cross. This righteousness that he gives to us is the forgiveness of sins. It's the absolution of all guilt. And that's what makes us confident. For it is guilt that makes us fear being in the presence of God. Whoever believes that his sins are pardoned by Christ Jesus is free of accusation, free of guilt, and therefore free of punishment from God. And that gives us confidence to wrestle with God like Jacob did. And that gives us confidence to keep coming back just like that widow did. This gift of righteousness and the acquittal is not an empty word. These promises are earned and paid for, not by any of us, but by God in the flesh, in the flesh of Jesus Christ. He lived the righteous life. He did not succumb to temptation. Neither did he ever resist or disobey the will of his Father. However, he didn't leave the obedient life for himself. Being truly righteous and obedient in himself, he needed nothing. But he led that life on behalf of this world. He led that life on behalf of all of us, you and me and everyone. He took our unrighteousness into his own account. Think of that. He took our unrighteousness into his account, and in exchange for that, he gifted to us his innocence and his righteousness. And that took him to the cross. Because he took our unrighteousness and our disobedience and counted them as his own, that put him under the death sentence. The wages of sin is death. And again, he did this on our behalf. Even though he is perfectly innocent, he took our guilt, placed it in his account, and he died in our place, in our behalf. Humanly speaking, this sounds too good to be true, doesn't it? But it is true, for the Word of God says that God made him, that is Jesus, to be sin on behalf of us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And faith says yes to that. Now I, by faith, am wearing the gift of Christ Jesus' righteousness. I am covered by the innocence of Christ Jesus. And that's where the confidence comes from. That makes us bold to take hold of the Lord just like Jacob did until he got the blessing. That makes us confident to go back and go back and go back just like that widow did before that judge. And so we are confident and we can be persistent and are persistent. And we boldly come before our Father with our petitions because Jesus has enabled us through his sacrifice. Through his death and his resurrection, we are welcome in the presence of God. And so we come to the question, how does this work in real everyday life? Christ Jesus has made us bold to engage the Father with all of our concerns, so how do we put this to work? And the answer is, it's both simple and complex. The practical application is simple and complex. And it's complex because each of us is different. We have different life experiences, different sins, different temptations, different weaknesses, different strengths, different health experiences, different vocational experiences, different financial experiences, and all these things. The Lord wants us to deal with them and come to him confidently and persistently in prayer, to wrestle with him and seek his blessing in all of our circumstances. And so it's different for everyone, and that makes it very complex. Yet it's simple. It's very simple. Because the one thing that remains the same through all our varied experiences is the confidence and the boldness to work through whatever our situation might be with Christ, bringing those things to our Heavenly Father. So we have that confidence to work through our life issues in prayer because the Lord invites, encourages, commands us to grab hold of him in all things, and he has made it possible by his cross and his resurrection and the promises that he has promised to hear us and to answer us. And so confidence, this confidence wrought by the cross, moves us to work through all things in the knowledge and confidence that in the end, he will bless us. No matter what the path to that end was, he will bless us. And the blessing is this, that through all these persistent struggles, through all the wrestling, what is really happening is the Lord is refining his children. He is transforming us through those times of wrestling with him in prayer. He is transforming us from being children of this world to becoming children of the kingdom of God. He is adding experience to our faith. Through the struggles and the persistence, we gain experience, and through experience, hope. Paul talks about that in Romans chapter 12. He talks about the transformation of our minds. He writes, "I beseech you, by the mercies of God, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." See how he leads us through experience to a transformation. It's by what? He says, "I beseech you, by the mercies of God." What are the mercies of God? The gospel, the cross, the resurrection for the forgiveness of sins. Those are the mercies of God. And those mercies of God open the Father's heart and invite us into his presence. By God's gentle mercies, he has not only changed our hearts, but he is renewing our minds. And the renewal of the mind is a lifelong process. By wrestling with the Lord, he is transforming our thinking. He is teaching us to understand life with the mind of Christ, not the mind of the world. And this happens in the study of Scripture and in prayer. Through the study of Scripture, we engage the mind and the Spirit of God. And that kind of devotional life is a conversation with God about everything that we encounter in life, whether it be our joys or our struggles. And if we understand Scripture like that, in prayer like that, it becomes compelling and exciting, and if you will, even fun. From that conversation, that wrestling with God, comes true prayer, by which we grab hold of him as Jacob did, and as the widow in the gospel reading. We cling to him until he relents and grants the blessing. Now, we always need to remember the blessing may or may not come out the way we expected in the beginning. But one thing is sure, in the end, it will be good. It will be most excellent. And I know many of us looking back on our life thought of some of the struggles we had were difficult, maybe all just impossible, and we looked for an outcome, but in the end, the outcome was just the right thing for us, and we got the blessing. Luther talks about this in his commentary on the book of Genesis. He describes this blessing of wrestling with God, and I quote now from that from his commentary. God, in his boundless goodness, dealt very familiarly with its chosen patriarch, Jacob, and disciplined him as though playing with him in a kindly manner. So God plays with him to discipline and strengthen his faith, just as a godly parent takes from his son an apple with which the boy was delighted. Not that he should flee from his father or turn away from him, but that he should rather be incited to embrace his father all the more and beseech him, saying, "Father, give back what you have taken away." Then the father is delighted with this test, and the son, when he recovers the apple, loves the father all the more, ardently seeing that such love and child's play gives pleasure to the father. That's Luther on wrestling with God. God, in his love for us, encourages us never to lose heart, for he condescends to us to wrestle with us like a loving father. He plays with us in the fatherly way, as we heard Luther say, and in that way, the Lord is raising up children. We are his children, children being refined in the knowledge and wisdom of our Heavenly Father through these things. The message of the gospel reading today is that we ought always to pray and not lose heart. With this parable, Jesus reveals the heart of our Father. It is his fatherly will and desire that we should come to him with our sins, our failures, our weaknesses, our joys, our accomplishments, our requests for his guidance, for all our needs, for our loved ones at home, at church, for all our neighbors in the world. He wants us to be confident and not lose heart. Whatever the circumstance is, wrestle with him. Keep coming back to him. And then the Large Catechism says, as we have done that, he says, this is Luther in the Large Catechism. He writes, make wide and open your cloak to receive much. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Let us pray. O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
hear us.
God the Father in heaven,
have mercy.
God the Son, Redeemer of the world,
have mercy.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy.
Be gracious to us.
Spare us, good Lord.
Be gracious to us.
Help us, good Lord.
From all sin, from all error, from all evil, from the crafts and assaults of the devil, from sudden and evil death, from pestilence and famine, from war and bloodshed, from sedition and from rebellion, from lightning and tempest, from all calamity by fire and water, and from everlasting death.
Good Lord, deliver us.
By the mystery of your holy incarnation, by your holy nativity, by your baptism, fasting, and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, by your precious death and burial, by your glorious resurrection and ascension, and by the coming of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter.
Help us, good Lord.
In all time of our tribulation, in all time of our prosperity, in the hour of death and in the day of judgment.
Help us, good Lord.
We poor sinners implore you
to hear us, O Lord.
To rule and govern your holy Christian church, to preserve all pastors and ministers of your church in the true knowledge and understanding of your wholesome word, and to sustain them in holy living, to put an end to all schisms and causes of offense, to bring into the way of truth all who have erred and are deceived, to beat down Satan under our feet, to send faithful laborers into your harvest, and to accompany your word with your grace and spirit.
We implore you to hear us, Lord.
To raise those who fall and to strengthen those who stand and to comfort and help the weak-hearted and the distressed.
We implore you to hear us, good Lord.
To give to all peoples concord and peace, to preserve our land from discord and strife, to give our country your protection in every time of need, to direct and defend our president and all in authority, to bless and protect our magistrates and all our people, to watch over and help all who are in danger, necessity, and tribulation, to protect and guide all who travel, to grant all women with child and all mothers with infant children increasing happiness in their blessings, to defend all orphans and widows and to provide for them, to strengthen and keep all sick persons and young children, to free those in bondage, and to have mercy on us all.
We implore you to hear us, Lord.
To forgive our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts, to give and preserve for our use the kindly fruits of the earth, and graciously to hear our prayers.
We implore you to hear us, Lord.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God,
we implore you to hear us.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
have mercy.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
have mercy.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
grant us your peace.
O Christ,
hear us.
O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
have mercy. Amen.
We continue with the service of the sacrament, beginning on page 194 at the preface. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and at all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of sun and cloud, and rendered our hope of thy glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he, blessed is he, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Oh,
give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endureth forever.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Please note, deacons, there's a deacons meeting immediately following the service.